Turn with me to the book of Numbers, chapter 6, verse 22. We're looking at a passage of scripture which is commonly known as the priestly blessing. And God tells this to Moses in verse 23. Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. So they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. Clear instructions God gives to Moses for Moses to pass on by speaking to Aaron and his sons. Aaron and his sons, the entire family represents the priesthood. They're called the Levites. And the Levites' responsibility was to speak a blessing over the people of Israel. Now we use the word bless or blessing so casually that we've forgotten the importance of why we use it. The people of Israel understood the importance of the power of blessing which is released upon their lives. The word blessing literally means empowered for success, empowered for prosperity or increase. That's the meaning of the word bless. So we're going to look at two words that summarizes this few passage of verses. And it is ordination and impartation. What are the two words? So these few verses speak about ordained and imparting. God had placed in the mouth of these priests the ability to speak a blessing that will transform lives. It's a divine ability that the priest only could operate in, empowered by God to impart a blessing. And when they do that, in verse 27 it says, so they will put my name on the Israelites and then I will bless them. His name represents his presence. When a blessing is spoken, it's the presence of God that is released and God confirms that blessing. It was the responsibility of all the priests. Aaron and his sons were set apart and anointed for this one task, speak a blessing. Today, you and I are called by God, chosen by God to be his priests. God has put in our mouth the ability to speak a blessing that will transform lives. He has chosen us for this one particular task to release the power of his blessings wherever we go upon people's lives. And I give you the scripture for that in 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9. It says, but you are a chosen generation. Every single one of us are chosen by God to be a chosen generation, to represent that generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. Now when you talk about choosing, when a person is playing a football game, the captain of the team makes his choice. Now he's not going to pick anybody. He's going to pick people who know the game, who understand the game, and who will be a team player. Isn't that right? And so here, the Bible is using the same word, God has chosen you. He's chosen every one of us to represent him, to be on his team in order to fulfill his objective. He has called us and chosen us as priests, not just priests, but royal priesthood. You see these two words coming together, royal priesthood, to release a blessing in the world we live in. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, the Bible says, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. So now not only God has ordained us, he has made us, he's appointed us. We can't make the choice. God makes the choice and appoints you as a chosen priest. And we fulfill the role of kings and priests. Kings decree. That's what kings do. They pass an order or ordinances. They speak. What do priests do? Priests bless. Now you put that two together. God has given every one of us as priests the spiritual authority to decree and to bless. Are you agreeing with me? Now I want you to tell someone next to you, and I want it to go like a chain effect. God has appointed me to be your priest. Tell someone next to you. You tell the person next to you, pass it on like a chain. Do you believe that? God has called you and anointed you to be the next person's priest. We are a priesthood of believers. Appointed by God, anointed by Him to represent one another before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We are a priest. Not just priest, but we are kings and priests. We decree and we bless everything that God brings across our path. That's our assignment. If you want to know what your calling, what's your purpose, this is your purpose. God has assigned for you a kingly and a priestly role. Revelation chapter 5 verse 10 says, and have made us kings and priests. How? By appointment to our God that we will reign on the earth. There is a spiritual authority that comes in operating in the office of a priest. And we need to hold this office of priesthood in a very sacred and respected way. In 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 8 tells us the qualities of the priest and the function of the priest. Are you with me? It says, finally, all of you be of one mind. He's talking to the priest, to the believers, having compassion for one another. Love your brothers, be tender-hearted, be courteous. Five qualities that describe a priest. Five qualities of every priesthood of a believer must have. Be of one mind. What one mind? Look at me for a moment. There is only one thing we must keep in mind. God has called us to speak a blessing, nothing more and nothing less. We as God's people represent Him and His team, His kingdom, for one thing, single-minded, I'm called to bless. Can you say this after me? I'm called to bless. And I'm not talking about only blessing your life, your wife and your children. You're called to bless people in general, especially the household of God, the believers of God. Speak a blessing. Be single-minded. You need to have compassion, the heart for one another. Love one another as brothers. No hidden agendas. No ulterior motives. Be tender-hearted. Be courteous. Be sympathetic. Five qualities that every priesthood of believer must have. Verse 9 describes our responsibility. Not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing. Why does God tell us not to repay evil for evil? Why does God tell us not to pay back hurt for hurt, reviling for reviling? It's because it continues, knowing that you were called to this, that you will inherit a blessing. We were called to bless, full stop. That's your appointment. That's what God has ordained us for. That's why God chose you to be a blessing. Represent Him and bless others. That's your calling. Some of you so take it so serious. God, what's my calling? Here's your calling. King and a priest. And then, because you're called to bless, it says the advantage is you inherit a blessing. You don't earn a blessing, you inherit a blessing. That means a blessing is given to you. You inherit that blessing as you position yourself in speaking a blessing. Verse 10. For he who would love life and see good days, and this is God's heart, God wants us to have good days and good life, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Now, if you're honest with yourself, if there's anything that's got you into trouble, it's your mouth. Ouch. Isn't that true? And today, the reason for conflict in the home, at your office, anywhere, friendship, the one thing that causes conflict is your speech, your tongue. And that's why the Bible is saying in verse 10, if you want to enjoy good life, if you want to enjoy prosperity and blessing, then all we got to do is refrain, hold back from speaking evil and speaking deceit. And the reason and the motivation for doing that is because God takes our office that he's called us to very seriously. As kings and priests, I have only one responsibility. What's that responsibility? I have only one responsibility, decree a blessing. So say this after me, please. As a king and a priest, I have only one responsibility, to decree a blessing on people. Do you know how much of your life will change? Do you know how much of your friendships will change when you begin to take this office seriously as a king and as a priest and say from this day onwards, all I will do is speak a blessing because that's what God has called me and appointed me for. Somebody shout an amen. Amen. I believe that there's another reason when the Bible says refrain or hold back from speaking evil, because we all face negative circumstances in life. There are things that people say to us, there are things that people do to us that almost provokes you to curse or to repay evil for evil. And so God is saying, hold back, use self-control, don't go that way. And the Bible gives us an example in the Old Testament concerning the king of Moab called Balak. And he enticed a prophet of God called Balaam or Balaam or whatever you want to say his name is, enticed him with money and says, I want you as a prophet to speak a curse on God's people. And that's exactly what happens today. The enemy is always enticing us to use our office of a king and a priest in a negative way instead of blessing. It provokes us to curse. And you see the story in the Bible as Balaam, enticed and swayed by the king's gesture, opens his mouth, but God stops him from speaking a curse over his people. But at the end of the day, the Bible records this prophet Balaam as a false prophet. It says, woke, there was a curse upon this prophet. And the Bible warns us, do not go down the way of Balaam. Do not indulge in speaking negatively, speaking things which are contrary to a blessing. Anything negative about a person is a curse. Blessing is what edifies people, builds people up, strengthens them. That's a blessing that you speak. And God has called us to be in that place. You see that in Jude chapter 11, the warning that God gives us. To summarize that, I would like to say if you want to live a good life, a prosperous and a successful life, one thing, hold your tongue from speaking evil and start speaking blessing. You know, we all come from ungodly backgrounds, all of us. There's no good sinner, sinner, sinner. And we have cultivated a habit of cursing anything we see. And we curse our life, we curse ourselves. That's the worst part. We curse our own self. Some people do a great job. You don't even need the devil around. You do something. Oh, I'm an idiot. Oh, I'm a foolish fella. Oh, I did this. Oh, I'm a failure. You curse yourself so much. Hey, God wants that to change. We see things that we don't like. We speak a negative word. We see the government. We curse the government. We curse anything in our past life. But God has pulled you out of that life. God has chosen you for a purpose. And the one thing that God wants you to understand, He's anointed you as a king and a priest to change your habit and start blessing everything you see. Everything that has life, you bless. Hello? Are you with me this morning? James chapter 3, verse 9 to 11 says, with the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings. Sunday morning, we bless God. During the week, we curse human beings. We say negative things about them. Very quickly, come spontaneously. That's one refrain. Stop yourself from doing that. Human beings who are made in the likeness of God. The biggest test is when you drive your vehicle on the road. I think Phillips cracked the joke and I used it. The child told his father, how come when daddy drives on the road, there are so many idiots on the road? Where do they come from? Only when daddy is driving. You got the joke? Don't tell me to explain the joke now. And you know, so easy it comes out of a mouth. Idiot, stupid, fellow, where you came from? You know, I'm being polite. People use worse words than I, cursing people. It's, you know, it should not be coming out of the same spirit. Verse 10, out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. I'm not saying it. The Bible is saying it. Can both fresh water and salt water flow out of the same spring? The answer is no. And so let's change the way we live life. Let's look at our Christian life beyond just being a believer, but operating and functioning as kings and priests. What privilege, what authority God has bestowed upon us. So we covered the first point, ordination. The second one is impartation. This is how God said, you will impart a blessing. The title of my message is Releasing the Power of God's Blessing. That's the title of the message. How do you release the power of God's blessing? We see that in Numbers chapter 6, verse 22. God telling Moses, this is how you bless the Israelite. Say to them. Can you repeat after me? Say to them. It didn't say pray for them. It says say to them. What it didn't say? It didn't say pray for them. It says say to them. Very wise. Say to them, the Lord bless you, keep you, and go on so forth. Then I will put my name on the Israelites. How? By speaking a blessing, and God will bless them. The word bless is about pronouncing words in a religious rite in order to invoke divine favor upon someone. Now, that's an ordinary dictionary meaning, and so you can look it up. This is what it means to bless. Pronouncing words, speaking words, that's what blessing is. Now, I've seen this in my own life. I've seen this in other people's lives. It's so easy to get into a closet where nobody hears you and say, Lord, I bless that person for all the wicked he's done for me. We come out of the closet and the occasion rises when you talk about that person. That person, he's a wiper. And God must be thinking, I thought you just asked me to bless him. And what do? We curse. Now, you know what? The Bible didn't say pray for a blessing. It says speak a blessing. It says speak a blessing. A blessing is when you speak to the person. And we must learn to speak that blessing in order to evoke a divine favor upon their life. All through the Gospels and the ministry of Jesus, the only one thing you see is that Jesus spoke a blessing and it transformed lives. Jesus spoke a blessing, released healing. Jesus spoke a blessing, brought encouragement. Everything about the ministry of Jesus was what he spoke And what happened as a result? God honored his priestly office. God honored the words that Jesus spoke. It was like a sharp sword in his mouth. And God blessed the people according to what he spoke. Isn't that true? There is only one thing I know Jesus cursed. Can you tell me which one? The fig tree. The only thing Jesus cursed was the fig tree. The problem with this now is that we curse people and bless trees. Are you with me? And you talk about a tree. Cutting the tree, we must protect the environment. You're slicing people left, right, and center with your words. You're undermining their ability, but you're worried about a tree. And the difference between Jesus and us is, Jesus blessed people and cursed trees. We bless trees and curse people. Something must change. Then we have animal rights, tree rights, environment rights, but human rights is another story. There are two primary Greek words that the Bible uses for the word bless. And the two meanings are happy and speak good of. What's the two meanings? Happy and good of. When the Bible says, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek, it's talking about happy as a person. The other references of speaking a blessing is coming from this root word to speak, bless. In Luke chapter 6, we're moving to the New Testament. Nothing changes. Jesus said to the disciples and the people, and look at what the Bible says in verse 27 and 28. But to you who are listening, now many of us hear things but don't listen. We're so used to hearing things but not really listening. So Jesus is addressing those who listen, not just willing to hear and then forget. Listening, saying to them, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you. Look at this. You bless those who curse you. You pray for those who mistreat you. And I looked at the play of these words. You bless those who curse you. That means you speak good to those who curse you. You pray for those who despitefully use you. He repeats that in verse 28. Bless those who curse you and pray for those who spitefully use you. Every time you speak negatively about your life, about other people, you're releasing a curse. Now, if you go like to do some study, go back home, read the remaining part of the scripture in Luke chapter 7, and you'll notice that there's a blessing. And 1 Peter says, do not repay evil for evil. Why? Because our calling as kings and priests is to bless. We are called to bless. And then in blessing, we inherit a blessing. In Luke chapter 6, you go down. It says, then you shall be called the sons of the Most High. Why did he say sons of the Most High? Because the sons of the Most High are entitled for inheritance. And the blessing of God will be upon our life when we begin to approach life with speaking a blessing rather than a curse. There is an interesting factor in this verse. Jesus is not talking about us asking God to bless our enemies. It's talking about us blessing our enemies. You know, we in this ministry, and we so often find this. You ask someone to forgive a person who's hurt you. They'll seriously pray, Lord, would you forgive the person for what they did to me? And I think to myself, God never struggled with unforgiveness. God has no problem with forgiving. But you know what? We dodge the issue. It sounds so religious. God, you forgive. God says, you forgive. We put that on God and say, no, you forgive. Are you with me? In the same way, God is saying, you bless. You speak good. We say, God, you bless. There is a spiritual principle that Jesus is introducing to us, which is speaking good even in times when it's contrary to our feelings and our thinking. Somebody is cursing you, but you choose to speak good for one reason: you honor the office of being a king and being a priest. That's what God has called us to be. That you honor it. And in honoring that office, you're setting yourself up for an inheritance of God's blessing. Now, I've noticed that whatever we don't like, we curse instead of blessing. Isn't that true? Whatever we don't like, we curse. You drive on the roads, you don't like it, we curse the road. Whatever you don't like, we quickly speak negatively. We do it at home. We'll tell our husbands, you'll never change. You'll always be like this way. Wives, you'll always eat my head. Finally, you won't have any brain left. Because we pronounce it so often. You see, we use those negative words. We curse our own life, our future. We speak words of hopelessness. What are you doing? You want to change something? Don't curse it, bless it. Please tell someone next to you. If you want to change something, don't curse it, bless it. Okay, I think you say this after me. Get it into your spirit. If I want to change something, I must bless it, not curse it. So if you have a husband that wants to change or needs to change, bless him, don't curse him. If you want a wife to change, don't curse her, bless her. If you want your children to study better or children to do better, please, for God's sake, don't curse them. And so often, parents can curse their children. You'll never get married. Who will ever marry you? Or what will happen? You'll never be a success. Hey, if you want to see your children blessed, speak a blessing. And in speaking a blessing, you inherit a blessing. They turn out to be a blessing, and they bless you in the end. If they turn out to be a pain in the neck, then you suffer. And that's why Jesus is saying, bless those who curse you, because you begin to change things. It has a powerful influence in the world you live in. Your words create life. Do you know who's your favorite preacher? Who? No, not me. You want to guess who's your favorite preacher? Your favorite preacher is yourself, because you listen to yourself more than what you listen to anybody else. Hello? If you agree with me, shout an amen. Amen. There you are. You're constantly listening to what you say. You're constantly listening to the thoughts that's in your head. You're constantly listening to what's going on in your spirit. And the more you hear yourself, the more you speak. And therefore, you can listen to many messages, but you're your own favorite speaker or preacher, because you ultimately do what you say. My only hope is that what you say is blessing your life and not cursing it. Because you listen to yourself all the time. You go to bed listening to yourself. You wake up in the morning listening to yourself. And you can start the day with either blessing people or cursing people. And very often it starts with the maid. It starts with the maid. It goes to someone else in the family, some spouse. Then you kick the door, you kick the dog. I don't know what else you kick. You go to work, you curse the boss there, you curse the timings there, you curse the road, and all on the road, on the way, you're hearing yourself preach yourself. This fella's idiot, that fella's idiot, that fella's idiot, this fella's fool, this fella, the government doesn't know what he's doing. You know, you listen to yourself so much, by the time you come home in the evening, if your wife gets to greet you, you're one big grumpy person. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. Those who love it will eat its fruit. If you love life, you will speak life. And when you speak life, you will eat the fruit of life. Somebody get excited and shout a big amen. Because your words create a world. And you live in the world you create by your words. And that's why God is saying, whatever you speak, you create. And whatever you create, you live in that environment. Grumpy people will always grumble, and they live in a world of grumbling. Even if there's something good, they'll grumble about that. For once something good came, that also becomes a problem. And then you say, why my life is miserable? I'd be surprised if it wasn't. You know, when you speak evil, you inherit evil. When you speak blessing, you inherit a blessing. I will establish that with scripture. The same energy it takes to speak negatively, I want you to know, it takes the same energy to speak something positively. Change the way you speak. Reframe. Don't give in to the temptation that Balaam the prophet gave into, wanting to speak a curse. Hold back and choose to speak a blessing. Honor the office that God has called you. What is your office? Say, I am a king and I am a priest. I wear victor's crown. Not mine, his crown, okay? So when we sing that song, we wear the victor's crown. We are talking about wearing his kingly role, his spiritual authority to decree and to bless. And that's why the combination of the two, royal priesthood, is a powerful combination. You rule as a king and you bless as a priest. You know, this is how people will know that you're a believer. They don't have to come to church and say, oh, you also come here. You're a believer, huh? I didn't know. They should know that in your workplace. They should know that when they hang around you. There's something on your life that they don't have. And that is the ability to speak a blessing and see it come to pass. You know, if you join in with the crowd and speak the same language that they speak, you inherit the same things that they inherit, and you may call yourself a believer. It makes no difference. Come with me to Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12 talks about the blessing of Abraham. We all know in Galatians chapter 3, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law so that we can inherit the blessing of Abraham. We also know that we are called the seed of Abraham so that we can enjoy the blessing of Abraham. And one of those blessings is in verse 2 and 3 where God tells Abraham, I will make you a great nation, I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. When God blesses you, he has more than you in his mind. You heard what I said? When he blesses you, he has more than you in his mind. That means he blesses you for a reason so that you will be a blessing to the nation. The blessing of God is not for our keeps. The blessings of God is for our blessing of others. Verse 3, this is the solemn part of this blessing. I will bless those who bless you. In other words, God's saying, everyone who blesses you, I will bless them. And then he says, I will curse those who curse you. So Abraham, don't worry about those cursing you. I will take care of them. You keep being a blessing to people and I will bless them. Those who curse you, I will curse myself. Ouch. And you know what happens? The enemy places us in a position where we curse people so much that we only inherit a curse and wonder why there's no blessing on our life. I didn't say this. God said this. And I know why he said it after meditating on it. Because God's saying, you honor the office I've called you for as a king and a priest, and you fulfill that, I will take care of everything that you need to take care of. And I will make sure. You see, just imagine, you bless one person, you get a blessing. You bless another person. Can you imagine this congregation will be woozing with blessings? Isn't it true? The whole Christian world will be a different place because we are a people who bless. That's why when people prophesy something negative, I don't like it. Because God never called us to that office of condemning and dealing with things in that way. He's called us to an office to decree and to bless. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. We will be vulnerable at times. There will be times that we will be pushed to the end. But remember the office that God has called you. And as a result of that, God says, you honor the office, I will increase your blessing. You will inherit a blessing and they will be blessed. You don't lose. You don't lose from God's side. You don't lose from their side. Both get a blessing. You get blessed, they get blessed. Is it making sense to you this morning? Now, how do we do this practically? And I know we use words to bless you. And sometimes it's only a good word to just encourage people. But the word blessing is more than just a good word. It's power empowered by God. We are called as his priest to do it, which will have an effect on people's lives. And so I've taken this part from a book which describes the acronym of the word bless so that we can be specific in the way we speak blessing over people's lives. And this is the acronym for the word bless. B talks about our body, our health, and our protection. So if you want to bless someone, you speak a blessing in the area of the health, that their health will increase. That God will protect them. God will be their protector. God will be their healer. L stands for our labor. So you speak a blessing on people concerning their labor, the work of their hands, that all the hard work you put in, it will bring forth result and bless you in return. Some people work tirelessly and don't get enough returns from what they do, the energy that they put in. Ask God to bless their work. Bless their income, their finances. E stands for our emotions, that God will bless our emotions. We will have love, we'll have joy, we'll be at peace. We'll carry around a positive emotions that bless people. S stands for our spiritual walk with God, that we will grow strong in the Lord and in the power of his mind. We'll be open to hearing the voice of God and be able to obey and honor him. And S stands for our social life, our marriage, our relationship with the family, our relationship with church and other believers. And so there are five things there. There's five areas where we can speak blessings into people's lives.